It's 2017, and because I'm such a dedicated techie committed to having the newest technology at my fingertips, I just got back from the store with a fascinating piece of technology. This video cassette recorder. You probably think of the VCR as an uninteresting, outdated piece of tech. But there's some surprisingly interesting stuff inside here. The VCR contains a device that solved what seemed to be an unsolvable problem. Let's have a look. In the days of analog television, the actual signal that made up the images to be put on the screen wasn't a set of instructions on how to build an image using pixels. Rather, it was a complicated high-frequency signal of continually varying intensity that contained rudimentary triggers to help a television build a coherent image based upon that signal's instantaneous strength, which corresponded to image brightness at a particular point on the screen. Anyway, an analog video signal is an insanely high frequency. Okay, it's actually not that high by today's standards, but bear with me. The 5 MHz signal of analog television made for a perfectly acceptable picture, and there weren't any problems when it came to everyday use. Except, that super high frequency meant that recording the video signal was impossible. Let me explain. Magnetic tape recording, already in use for recording audio signals from microphones, has its frequency response, that is, how high a frequency it can reproduce, limited by its speed. Due to the structure of the tape itself, to record a high-frequency signal it has to be moving past the tape heads pretty fast. Now, this isn't a problem for audio signals, as the highest frequency it needs to produce is about 20,000 Hz or 20 kHz. A speed of 7.5 inches per second is plenty for this purpose. But video signals are about 5 MHz, that's 5 million Hz, much too high a signal to put on normal tape. Because of this limitation, TV shows tended to be live and not pre-recorded. If a show was to be recorded before being broadcast, it was usually filmed with a conventional motion picture camera, and then a device called a Telecine would be used. A Telecine is a machine that can convert motion picture film into a television signal. Aside from the necessary frame rate conversion that was accomplished by the machine, you can think of it as a glorified television camera pointing at a movie screen. You could also use a kinescope, which was basically the opposite, like pointing a film camera at a TV screen, the upshot of which was that frame rate conversion wasn't necessary when playing it back due to an already matched frame rate. But using film wasn't easy, and most importantly, it wasn't cheap. It would be super convenient to put video signals right onto magnetic tape, which was cheaper and easier to use, not requiring film processing, and also being reusable. But again, speed was a problem. In order to record video signals onto this tape, it would have to be traveling at many feet per second. With this 1200-foot spool of tape, you could expect a recording time of about 72 seconds. It would look a lot like this during normal operation. But that didn't stop progress. At first, attempts were made to just make a really big, really fast tape recorder. One such system, the Vision Electronic Recording Apparatus, or VERA, was developed in 1952 by the BBC, the project being led by, now here's an awesome name, Dr. Peter Axon. The VERA used massive 20-inch reels that contained 15,000 feet of tape. That's nearly 3 miles of continuous tape. Yikes. But even with that vast amount, the recording time was only 15 minutes, because the tape traveled at 16.7 feet per second, or over 11 miles an hour. If it wasn't obvious that this was impractical, well, it should have been. Other oddities exist in the linear videotape world, such as Toshiba's LVR system that used a loop of tape that moved very fast, and a head that slowly moved along the tape from top to bottom, essentially making a spiral. But for the most part, the idea was abandoned because, let's face it, this is just silly. So what could be done to practically record video onto magnetic tape? There's no getting around the fact that the tape has to travel past the heads at least a dozen feet per second or so to get a reasonable picture. To solve this problem, the American company Ampex, based in California, asked a brilliant question. Why not have the heads move past the tape? Ampex's revolutionary quadruplex system used a rotating drum containing 4 tape heads that sat perpendicular to the traveling path of 2-inch wide magnetic tape. The drum, rather than the tape, is what moved at a high speed. Spinning at a rate of 3600 RPM, the heads traveled past the tape very, very fast, but the tape only moved at a speed of 15 inches per second. By slicing up the width of the tape into small parts of the video signal, the surface of the tape could be used much more efficiently. Electronics switched the output between the 4 heads, allowing for a seamless video signal. The Ampex machine was a hit, and it quickly became the standard format for television studios nationwide. But these machines were insanely expensive, with the 1956 price being $45,000, equivalent to almost $400,000 today. Aside from costing more than a house, they were also huge, about the size of a large chest freezer, not including their many electronic components mounted on racks. And not to mention, they were obviously very heavy, along with being decidedly not easy to use, requiring training to operate them. Fast forward to the mid-1970s, and consumer videotape recorders are starting to appear. Betamax and VHS were the two most common formats, with VHS eventually winning the drawn-out format war. Both of these formats use similar technology to the original quadruplex system, so let's have a look at what's on the inside. This is a run-of-the-mill VHS cassette recorder from the early 80s. All VCRs contain a video head system similar to the quadruplex system. That's it there. But before we get too involved in that, let's have a look at the cassette itself. Any cassette tape is really nothing more than magnetic tape stored inside of a plastic shell so it can be handled more easily and so the machine can interact with it automatically. The audio cassette used a relatively simple system of three access holes located on the bottom edge of the cassette that the erase head, play head, and pinch roller could fit inside of. This works fine for the relatively uncomplicated process of moving audio tape past two stationary heads, but for a video format, the tape has to go in many places and most importantly, it has to wrap around the video head drum. Earlier machines had to be threaded manually, but that isn't exactly consumer-friendly. To accomplish threading automatically, the machine actually removes some of the tape from the cassette and pulls it through the path of the heads. Cutouts in the bottom of the cassette allow for two spindles to stick up behind the tape. As the cassette is lowered into the machine, the hinged lid, which keeps the tape away from grubby little hands, is opened, and once play is selected, the spindles move towards the rear of the machine, which pulls the tape past all the necessary components. Let's look at some of the components inside without a cassette in place. The path the tape makes is in the shape of an M. First, it travels past this erase head. When recording, the erase head is energized, which removes any signals currently on the tape, allowing it to be reused. Its next stop is the video head drum. After being wrapped around, it exits the drum and goes past two more stationary heads. These heads record the audio and a tracking signal. These two signals are recorded along the edges of the tape. Obviously, the audio track contains sound. Meanwhile, the tracking signal contains reference pulses to match each frame of video. The recorder uses the pulses to maintain the correct tape speed when playing a tape back. It also allows for the machine to compensate for slight differences between tapes recorded on different machines, enabling video tracking. Later machines use the tracking pulses as a sort of time code, counting each pulse to determine how much time had elapsed. The last main component is the capstan and pinch roller. These components work together to squeeze the tape between themselves. The capstan spins at a very precise speed, and that's how the tape is actually pulled through the mechanism. Cogged spindles engage with the spools that hold the tape from the bottom, but they only actually pull the tape with force when fast-forwarding or rewinding. Otherwise, they simply serve to spool the tape and keep it taut, with the capstan doing the real work. So let's go back to the most exciting part, the video head drum. Here lies the heart of the machine. If you remember the days of VCRs, you probably remember this sound. That's the sound of the head drum starting to spin. For machines in the US, it spins at roughly 1800 RPM. One complete revolution makes one frame of video, and since the frame rate of US television is 29.97 frames per second, it spins at nearly 30 times a second, or 1800 RPM. But where are the heads themselves? Well, the heads are really tiny and hard to see. They're tucked away in the slit that separates the two halves of the drum. All VHS recorders have at least two heads. Because NTSC video is interlaced, each head records half of the video frame at one time. Upmarket VCRs would have four or even six heads, with the extra heads helping to improve image quality by recording a more precise signal tailored to the specific tape speed. You might have noticed that the head drum doesn't sit level with the rest of the machine. In fact, it sort of looks like it was just tossed in there and let to stay where it landed. But in fact, the wonky angle is deliberate. If you look closely, you'll see that the head travels diagonally down the surface of the tape. One pass of the head, and thus one half frame or field of the video signal, is recorded on this long distance of tape. This is called helical scanning. By running the heads along the tape in this fashion, the tape didn't have to be nearly as wide as the 2-inch tape found in the quadruplex system, and it also meant that one pass of the head contained an entire video field. See, because the quadruplex system broke up the fields into multiple sweeps, requiring 16 head passes per full frame of video, it wouldn't produce any sort of intelligible picture unless playing at the right speed. This meant fast-forwarding or rewinding was done blind, and freeze-framing wasn't possible. Using one sweep for one complete field eliminated those problems. If you could see the information on the tape, it would look like this. Two linear tracks are present at the edges, and a bunch of long diagonal lines fill the middle. Each of these lines is one half of one frame of video, a field. Each field fills in the whole screen, but only every other line of the image. Every sweep of the heads along the helical path of the tape made half of the image, with the other head sweeping by to create the other half. The VCR would automatically switch what it showed on the television back and forth between the two heads, creating an apparently seamless image. Now, here's an interesting question. You might be wondering how the machine is actually able to read the tape. If the heads are spinning around, well, they can't have wires attached to them like the stationary heads do, or they'd tangle. Early videotape recorders used what's called a slip ring pickup, essentially a set of thin wires that brushed against the spinning ring, which was connected to the heads. These proved problematic, however, as corrosion and wear would introduce noise to the signal. By the time VHS was invented, rotary transformers were used to provide a wireless coupling between the top and bottom halves of the head drum. The actual slices of tape that made up the signal are very thin. The tape traveled at only 1.313 inches per second, and with 60 slices of video field squeezed in that space, you're looking at a slice width of about 0.022 inches, or just slightly more than half a millimeter. To help avoid interference between the tiny tracks on the tape, the heads were assembled with different azimuths, that is, different angles between the tape and the head. Rather than hitting it straight on, one head would hit the tape at plus 7 degrees, and the other at minus 7. This created destructive interference between the two tracks, thus ensuring each head picked up only what it was supposed to. This became even more important as the long play, LP, and then super long play, or SLP, recording speeds were introduced. LP halved the normal tape speed and thus halved the width of the track, with SLP only being a third the standard speed. This doubled and tripled the amount of time you could record on the tape, but it reduced the quality of the images noticeably, particularly when recording at the SLP speed, as now the width of the tracks created by the heads was less than 0.2 millimeters. The tape-to-head speed of consumer formats wasn't quite fast enough to reproduce broadcast quality images. VHS had a bandwidth of only 3 MHz, compared to broadcast bandwidth of 5. This meant that the quality of the signal coming from the tape wasn't quite as good as live TV. Are you ready? This is VHS quality. No joke, this has been recorded onto a VHS tape, fed through a capture device, and then back into this video. If you're not watching full screen, you should be. It's awful!
But keep in mind that back in the day, we weren't using massive TVs with 4K displays, let alone even 720p. On an old tube set, this quality was perfectly adequate.
Let's discuss those different recording speeds, shall we? This is what you could expect from a recording made at the standard play speed. This is the best picture you're gonna get, folks, and it goes downhill from here. Now I'll switch to LP. LP's not terrible, but sound quality got noticeably worse. Now here's SLP. Wowzers, not only does the picture quality look noticeably more awful, but the sound has taken a dive. Remember, the whole reason we need the spinning heads is because we need a very high tape speed to record the high-frequency video signal. Since the sound is recorded on the linear tracks at the edge of the tape, the really slow speed of an SLP tape at less than half an inch per second makes the sound quite unbearable, as virtually no high-frequency sounds are recorded. But people put up with it. With SLP speed, 6 hours could be recorded on one T120 tape. And in the early days of VHS, a blank tape could cost $25 or more in 1979 money, about $85 today. That's a lot, so getting the most time out of the tape was to most people more important than having the best picture quality. However, the later development of VHS Hi-Fi, which stored FM stereo audio within the video signal of the tape using a second set of heads on the video drum, meant that sound quality was constant even with an EP tape, and it's really good too. VHS Hi-Fi has a full 20 to 20 kHz frequency response, excellent signal-to-noise ratio in addition to dynamic range, and excellent stereo channel separation as well. It was very close to CD quality, with many people, myself included, not being able to tell the difference. Thus, the best way to play 8 hours of music non-stop in 1985 was to record your favorites on a T160 tape running at SLP speed on a Hi-Fi equipped VCR. The only caveat to VHS Hi-Fi was that because the audio was recorded along the helical scanned portions of the tape, the source of the sound had to switch back and forth with the heads. Now, our ears are actually far more sensitive to gaps in information than our eyes. So if the tape was damaged, or if the heads didn't line up quite right, you would hear a low 60Hz buzz. Ordinarily, though, this was a fairly rare occurrence. As a side note, for reasons I don't really understand, the LP speed disappeared from many VCRs. Though all but the very earliest VHS recorders can play back a tape made at the LP speed, few made after the 1980s could record at that speed. I remember as a kid in the 90s being a little bummed when our new VCR couldn't record in LP, as I found it a nice compromise between recording time and picture quality. Oh well, I guess only 90s kids remember. The longer recording time available on VHS was the main reason that Beta didn't win the format war. Sony's decision to use a smaller cassette with less actual tape inside meant that the longest tapes could typically hold was 4.5 hours, compared to the 8+ possible with VHS. VHS was continually improved during its life, with the most noticeable improvement being the SVHS standard released in 1987. SVHS, short for Super VHS, could record a 5.4 MHz signal with the improved tape formulation and recording techniques, actually providing a better picture than broadcast television. This was only half true though, because while the luminance bandwidth was very good, SVHS did not improve the color rendering of standard VHS. See, on VHS and Beta as well, the bandwidth required to make the image was dedicated mostly to luminance, or a black and white signal. VHS uses a color under encoding method whereby color data recorded after the luminance signal is essentially drawn on top of a black and white image. This was done to prioritize image sharpness with the limited bandwidth available. The resolution of this coloring was by contrast quite poor, on the order of just 12% that of the black and white detail. So while the picture of SVHS was sharper than broadcast TV, the color rendering left a lot to be desired. Partly because of this, and along with the significantly higher price tag of SVHS machines and media, SVHS never really went anywhere. Standard VHS was good enough. You might be surprised to learn that towards the end of VHS's life, DVHS was introduced, with the D standing for digital. It is certainly possible to record digital data onto magnetic tape, and the DVHS equivalent of a standard T120 tape could hold 25 gigabytes, the same as a single-layer Blu-ray disc. In fact, the DVHS standard included support for 1080i video. You should definitely check out these video clips from one of my favorite YouTubers, Techmoan, where he shows a demo tape with HD scenes of New York from 1994. It's actually kind of jarring to see street footage of that age in that clarity. As I close this video out, I hope that you can admire the ingenuity in these old machines. These intricate mechanisms and out-of-the-box thinking that led to their creation are, to me, just more fun. The video head drum solved an unsolvable problem in an ingenious fashion, and the intricacies involved in the machine just to get the tape to wrap around it are far more interesting than a laser diode and an optical pickup reading data off a spinning disc. We'll be exploring VHS and Beta as well in more detail, and I'll also be discussing the format war between them in later episodes. Thanks so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed the video. If you did, I'd ask that you be sure to give it a thumbs up and hit subscribe to Technology Connections. I'm doing my best to keep videos like this coming your way. I'll see you next time. For those of you that made it all the way to the end of the video, enjoy this bonus shot. I thought it would be fun to record the spinning video head drum at a very high shutter speed. Since the camera records at 30 frames per second, it should appear motionless. However, the camera's rolling shutter introduced some unintended side effects.